present our assignment, but to tell you three beautiful stories. So I'll begin with the first story. To form a base, what exactly is information and communication technology? It is the basic building blocks of information in a society. Having information in the system is really important. The person who has the information has a competitive advantage over the other in the corporate world. And at the same time, it also has a huge cultural value. And in the modern era, it's a complex, sophisticated system. And these are the main platforms of communication: mass media, internet, telecommunication, and digital transmission arrays. But going back to the feudal era, communication was more of art and architecture, and the kind of platforms you had were not this enormous. It was art, architecture, religion, speech, songs, drama, etc. So coming to our story, once upon a time there was a small boy in the city of Florence, and he was from the Medici family, who had great vision of making fortune. He was a self-made man, and with his vision to make a fortune, he started the Medici Bank, which was a huge success, which was taken forward by Cosimo, his son. Cosimo was also had political interest, so he was the first one to enter the politics of Florence, and he was a de facto ruler of Florence. Next comes Lorenzo. Lorenzo achieved a first-class education because of the huge fortune his father had. So he was a huge patron of art. Next, we have Cosimo I the Great, who was the first Duke of Florence. And then the Medici family also entered into the church and became, and one of the descendants became the Pope. And then we had the Grand Duke Cosimo II. So what exactly are we seeing here? A person who was a merchant, a mere merchant, as in a person from the family who was a mere merchant, ended up becoming a grand duke and got the whole country, whole city under their rule. How exactly is this happening? The magical potion for this is art. What exactly happened is, they used art to communicate their idea, to transform their identity. Initially, they commissioned chapels. They had this portrait inside the chapel. As you can see, there is a skull over there where the painter is trying to depict that this is something abnormal. Why? What is he trying to say here? Money lending, which the Medici family were into, was a sinful deed according to the feudal era, according to Christianity. They were not allowed to enter into the chapel as such. So, but because there was this other notion that if they commissioned art and architecture in the chapel or in the church, that is how they could mitigate their sinful deeds. So this is how it began, commissioning art and architecture. Now they commissioned all these other paintings. As you can see, if you go from this painting to this one in a proper selection, you could see that the paintings, in the first painting, they're associating with God. They're depicting themselves in that place, in history. They're associating themselves with God. Then they become God. Here you can see that Cosimo, the family, is depicted with God-like features, with muscles and not natural features, basically. And here you can see that the painting, the fresco, also depicting the same. How was it communicated to the mass? They used the sign. So what exactly is happening here? You have this logo, if you can relate it to. So this is the sign. This is symbolizing the Medici family. So the grandeur of the painting is being rubbed off onto the Medici family through this sign. So the ideology here is prestige. This is the transformation which is happening. This is the transformation which is happening, and if you look at one particular painting which has was visible to only the elite which entered into their houses, not everyone. So here you can see this is the whole Medici family. They are traveling to Bethlehem to meet the Christ. So this is a history painting, and as you can see there is an illusion of 3D created on a 2D painting, on a 2D plane. And the objects which are being depicted, like the horse, as in the beautiful horse, the ornaments, the gold, the kinds of colors, everything depicts a high class taste. So they are associating themselves with a rich cultural background and also the Holy Christ. And here this is nothing but this is Cosimo I, who has been depicted in the painting itself. So this is how they try to elevate their status in the society. The other painting, which is Ponticelli's Adoration of Mary, here by now the Medici family is really famous in Florence, and Del Lama, the person in the red hood, he is a fraud during that particular time, and he is trying to mitigate his negative image in the society by associating himself with the Medici family, who are to the right, and the Holy family. So this is how he is trying to mitigate his negative image. So when a person is coming out into the Florence city, they are being bombarded with this sign. So what exactly do they see? They see this city which has been transformed and beautified with the different kinds of structures, art and everything. And what they see is this sign which is symbolizing Medici. So there's a transformation from transformation of the Medici family from a money-lending community to this rich high class. So this is how art has been used by the Medici family, and they completely transform the way they communicate, the way how art has been used to communicate with the masses. And now Manpreet will tell you another beautiful story.
Good evening everyone. Now coming to the story in the current perspective, which is an amazing example. Like she mentioned about the Medici family in the Renaissance time. Now we come to the Tata family, which is now the most respected brand in the country, or not in the country but in Asia. How it started, a businessman from Parsi community from Gujarat, Jamshedji Tata. He is a local merchant. He started, founded an Empress mill, a steel mill in Nagpur. So, and which later on became the foundation of the Tata Group as we know today. So what happened was, these people were merchants, but with their idea, they started their business with three things: integrity, ethics and values, which Tata is still known for. They started this business with these three values, and they have never compromised with that. So these people who were merchants before, slowly and slowly I will tell you how they became leaders. Jamshedji Tata founded the Express Mill Tata Group, and after him, his son went abroad for education, Durauji Tata, for his various contributions, which I will explain. He was given knighthood by the British and he became Sir Durauji by Tata. His major contribution was the Taj Mahal Hotel in Mumbai. So, like I said, the brand name Tata, T-A-T-A Tata symbolic, they started with a steel mill, but it became so huge that they established Indian Institute of Science in Bangalore, then the Tata Steel Plant, one of the largest plant in the world, then the Taj Mahal Palace. So what was happening was, the brand name Tata became so huge that it started depicting the country, the established Indian Institute of Science and the Taj Mahal Palace. In those times it was like, they were doing, developing and transforming their business. Along with it, they were transforming the India as a country in the pre-independence era. Then came J.R.D. Tata, the man, he was the head of Tata, chairman of Tata from 1928 to 1992. He was the person responsible for establishing many industries, and the airline became known as Air India. With the help of government, he established Air India in 1946, and these are one of the major achievements. He was the highest civilian honor award, Bharat Ratna, in 1992. out of his major contributions, he founded Tata Motors, TCS, Titan, Tata McGraw-Hill and Tata Tea. So what happened was, like she said, after independence, when the country needed lots of development and all, there was only one group at that time which was seen like that, Tata, so everybody went to them. So by diversifying into business, that they made, like the Medici family used art, they used their business to communicate, and they diversified into many fields, and with their ethics and values, the development that they were doing was synonymous with the development of the country. The whole country seen the major reason for the development of the country. And from 1992 to 2012, when Tata was the chairman of Tata Industries, he took Tata to new heights. Not only in India, it became a really global conglomerate. It acquired various international, various joint ventures and acquired various companies. Along with it, from since beginning, here is a picture of J.R.D. Tata and here is a picture of Ratan Tata. They believed in the sustainability of business. Since its inception, they have been involved in sustainability and corporate social responsibility. So, I can name you many brands which have even crossed Tata in, we call it money, if it designs industries or Aditya Birla Group you can take. But no one has earned the respect that Tata has because of their values and how they have communicated their values since their inception. So now Tata is the most trusted brand in the country.
We'll now move on to the third little story we have, which is the story of Starbucks. So, if you look at Starbucks abroad, in the US where it was started, it was a common man's coffee. That's how they protected themselves. They began with larger stores where people used to come and sit down. But what they started doing is they started also having these smaller stores. And soon, as a result of which, the smaller stores started cannibalizing the larger stores because people would now just grab their coffees from the smaller stores and go, and as a result, nobody stayed around and stuck around in the large shops. This created a problem for Starbucks because, so now in the US they had two kinds of models, one of which seemed to not work. In this scenario they came to India. When they came to India, they completely changed their position. They sort of put themselves out as a little more premium. If you notice just the interior decor of the Starbucks India compared to Starbucks US, there it was more of a functional decor. It was more like just sit down chairs, not really about comfort or anything, it was about convenience. Whereas if you look at the Indian stores, you can see the plush chairs, the lighting, and the entire decor seemed to sort of signify premiumness, which didn't go with the Starbucks brand as such internationally. So if you look, there was a form versus content dichotomy that was happening. Form was an international brand, so they put themselves out there as Starbucks with an international brand. But in India, they positioned themselves differently, which led to this confusion in the mind of the consumer. How did they do it? They piggybacked on the Tatas. So now it's Tata Starbucks in India. So the idea is that in India, it's a collaboration with the Tatas. However, instead of calling it a collaboration, we're going to call it a piggyback. The framework we've used to sort of see how this piggybacking works is what we call FIRE. Fit, identification, respect and empathy. Fit is how well do the two organizations fit, the piggybacker and the piggybackee. Identification is how well does one identify with the one who's doing the backing. Respect is do we have respect for the backer. And empathy is, can we empathize with the person who's being backed? So if we go back to our first story of the Medici family, we can see that the Medici family piggybacked on art as well as Christianity to gain prestige. We look at this painting once again, and this time we look at it from the point of view of the framework. If we look at the fit of the Medici family as well as the backer, who in this case was Christ, or religion, we see that they're put in a single painting, they're put in a single frame, they're made to fit within a single theme. This led to a good fit. Both the Medici family member, which is Cosimo, as well as the concept of the Magi, which are the three horses symbolizing the three wise men, sort of allowed easy identification of what was going on. There was deep respect for religion, who is the backer in this case, and empathy for Cosimo Medici or the Medici family. Empathy because of two reasons. Number one was that the painting was so lifelike that you thought you were actually there, you could actually picturize it happening. Second was that you could see somebody who was in front of you, or the Medici, Cosimo Medici in this case, going towards Christ, which was a place where most of the people standing in the chapel wanted to be. They wanted to be closer to Christ, and they saw themselves, and they saw Cosimo on his way to Christ, and they sort of empathized with that. So this is what we would call a good fit, fitting with our framework. However, if we look at the Starbucks coffee and Tata coffee, who are the the joint venture is between Starbucks coffee and Tata coffee, not Tata as a whole. Tata coffee is a plantation. It's a coffee plantation. It's not a brand. So the thing is kind of confusing because the coffee plantation is normal coffee. They don't create premium coffee. There is so in India, when they position themselves as a premium brand, there's this confusion as in why are they collaborating with Tata Coffee. In terms of identification, how many of us have actually heard of Tata Coffee? I mean, we can see the Tata there, so we know it must be something important, I mean something big. But Tata Coffee is not that well heard of. How much respect do we have for Tata Coffee? We don't know how we respect it. And empathy, I mean, this lack of fit creates this dissonance in the mind of the consumer. So, Starbucks coffee and Tata coffee for us, in our framework, didn't seem to be a good fit. What we do suggest is if Starbucks coffee had said that they were doing a joint venture with Tata as a conglomerate. Now, the Tata conglomerate is seen as more of a premium setup. They're seen as talking about respect, commitment, empathy. This would create a better fit, we felt, with Starbucks, especially because in India they're positioning themselves to be a premium brand. And this is how we sort of envision our framework and the solution to the managerial problem. Thank you.